Welcome. My name is David Hall. I am the president of the University of the Virgin Islands, and I want to welcome all of you to this global outreach program with the focus on STEM. The University of the Virgin Islands is proud to partner with NASA in supporting this effort. It is critical to the Virgin Islands, to this nation, and to the world. I want to first thank NASA for all of the support it has provided down through the years to the University of the Virgin Islands. We would not have a physics program without their support, and we are proud to be one of the few HBCUs in the nation that offer degrees in physics to our students. Second, I want to thank Dr. David Morris, one of our faculty members who has been a pioneer for us in creating the physics program, for taking our observatory, our Edelman Observatory, to an entirely different level, and for all of the work he has done with NASA and forming this partnership. I also want to thank the leaders of our Caribbean Center for Green Technology, Greg Quinnell, Ms. Chans, Christina Chans, for their work around climate change, which is a focus of this outreach effort. But more importantly, I want to thank and welcome all of the students who will be participating in this gathering, especially those from the Virgin Islands, who we are very proud to have them participate, but the individuals from around the world who will be participating in this global outreach effort are welcomed and should be applauded. STEM and the development of more talent in STEM fields is not only critical to the growth of this nation, but critical to the growth of the world. We will not be able to provide the leaders for economic development, for innovation, if we do not have the requisite number of students in STEM fields. But it is not just economic development and innovation, but as the COVID pandemic has demonstrated to us, we need individuals who are knowledgeable in the healthcare arena, knowledgeable about infectious diseases and all of the ramifications that come from healthcare challenges. These are STEM fields, and we believe that it is important to inspire students at an early age to get them aware of the various career paths and to pursue these areas. And so finally, I want to just indicate that we are proud to host this event. The university, we pride ourselves in trying to be a leader in STEM development, and not just STEM development in general, but especially among those students and groups who are often absent from STEM fields. Unless we are able to tap into all of the resources that are available in our nation and in the world, we will not be able to meet the challenges that we face. And this gathering and this university and NASA are deeply committed to that vision. Welcome. I hope the next few days will be enlightening, inspiring, and will leave a mark on each of you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mirza Beg, 18th student, and I love physics.
Hi, I'm Shalani Talama, 8th grade student, and I love biology.
Hi, I'm Sanaya King, I'm an 8th grade student, and I love chemistry.
UVI Water Ambassadors and Future Scientists of Adelita Kankrine Junior High School.
My name is Cecile Penn, and I am a science teacher at the Adelita Kankrine Intermediate and Junior High School. I have been involved with UVI and the Water Ambassadors Program for more than 8 years. On behalf of UVI President Dr. Hall, the College of Science and Math, and UVI Caribbean Green Technology Center, we want to welcome our colleagues at school across the territory, nationally and internationally.
Trunk Bay, United States, Virgin Islands. Notice the clear blue seas and the beautiful beaches that describe Hull, Megan's, and Trunk Bay. Join me as I take you on a virtual tour of the USVI. Megan's Bay. The water is usually very calm with no waves of current, great for floating along and for swimming. The bay deepens gradually from shore, making it perfect for small children. Snorkeling is possible along the rocky coast. However, Megan's Bay is not known for good snorkeling, but for the water sports boat rents, paddle boats, kayaks, and sunfish. Beaches, floats, and snorkel sets are available at the concession. Trunk Bay. Ensconced within U.S. Virgin Islands National Park is Trunk Bay in St. John, USVI. The bay's location within the Virgin Islands National Park ensures that the archipelago remains free of aggressive, unsympathetic development, making it one of the most pristine of all places in the Caribbean. The area consists of 3/10 of a mile-long beach that surrounds a half-moon-shaped body of water.
Climatologists, meteorologists, and hydrologists all across the nation who work with researchers at UVI. The scientists from NOAA, National Weather Service, USVI, and many others who use these baseline indicators of droughts. You see, in the USVI, to use in their homes for rooftop collection. What the researchers who review this data see is the stress of vegetation, erosion, and compare these images to others taken over longer periods to determine what the impacts of drought are in the USVI and the region. This helps USDA and the Farm Service Agency aid farmers in the territory when severe drought impacts the island. Right now, we are facing drought conditions, and it appears based on the research here, the territory is headed into an earlier drought season than in years past.
To our fellow future scientists watching today from all across the globe, we hope you enjoy the presentations presented by students across the USVI and the nation as we learn more from NASA scientists about how we as students can join the ranks of NASA and begin our journey to UVI and other universities and study STEM to make this world a better, safer place for all of us.
And now, on to NASA's presentations. Thank you.
My name is Dr. Stacy Klein-Gardner, and I'm an adjunct professor of biomedical engineering at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. I have the pleasure of serving as the co-principal investigator and co-director of the Engineering for Us All project, or E4USA. The E4USA program seeks to demystify and democratize engineering for us all. The overarching goal is to introduce a broad spectrum of students and their teachers to engineering careers through a high school level introductory engineering course. E4USA is so very proud to be represented so strongly today in this wonderful gathering of scientists and engineers. Many thanks to our colleagues at the University of the Virgin Islands for this opportunity. We hope that more high schools around the U.S. will visit our website, e4usa.org, to learn more and consider joining us. Now, off to a wonderful session.
Hi. Let me extend a warm welcome to my fellow scientists and engineers that are joining us today. Greetings from Brentwood High School at Brentwood, Tennessee. We're just south of Nashville. Good to see you all here. We're a proud member of E4USA for the last 3 years, so from its inception. Some of our projects that we work on deal with problems at the school, such as missing locks from the bathroom stalls and how we could possibly lock them for ourselves. Other projects that we work on extend outside of the school through our community partners and partnerships with them, such as with the Nashville Zoo. We're looking forward to spending a little bit of time with you today. Thank you.
Good day, fellow scientists and engineers. Greetings from Brentwood High School, located in Brentwood, Tennessee, just south of Nashville. We are a proud original member of the Engineering for Us All program. Through E4USA, we have learned the importance of the engineering design process, the effectiveness of a strong team dynamic, and the huge impact that creativity has on the entire world.
Right now, we are working on an engineering problem at our own school. Brentwood High School has a separate STEM building from the main high school, so teachers, students, administrators, and SROs have to walk outside on uncovered sidewalks no matter what the weather is. We are interviewing our stakeholders now to make sure we define our problem well. We're planning to address the overall problem using preventative and reactive measures to protect people's belongings.
Before the end of the year, we look forward to solving problems posed by several community partners. We'll create enrichment toys for animals at the Nashville Zoo, design a repair tool for the safety measures around the Nashville Super Speedway track, and solve a problem for the Vanderbilt University Medical Center's Department of Neurosurgery.
Thank you!
All Saints Cathedral School in St. Thomas, U.S. Virgin Islands. I'm the head teacher of the E4USA platform at our school. Our students have taken an engineering journey from day one to where they are now. In this video, they're going to show you where we've gone, what we've done, what they experienced. There's many great things in E4USA, and our students are more than excited to move forward into engineering, even into the college level where they want to go. So thank you for your time. I hope you enjoy our presentation, and for sure, engineering for all.
My name is Ashwin Kim. I am a student at Austin Cathedral School. I am in 12th grade, and I really enjoy engineering. Now, let me turn it over to my friend.
Good morning, my name is Hugh Wing. I'm also a student at Our Saints Cathedral School, and I'm in the 11th grade, and engineering class is the best thing I ever took.
Hello, my name is Isaiah Francis. I'm also a student at Our Saints Cathedral School. I'm in the 12th grade, and I'm glad I took the class.
Here's a video that we made to reflect on our engineering journey.
Here we are, day number three on our table. Our frame is painted. Good morning, how you doing? All right, you're gonna start by us using the drill. Go ahead. Oh my God. We're gonna hear, oh my.
Good morning, everybody. We are in engineering. Today, we are starting our robot challenge. Everybody's ears are smoking as they start thinking about how this is going to work. Good morning. Here we are, engineering class, creating a rain shelter. They're brainstorming the process. We will have an update later. Awesome class. Everybody's hard at work. Oh yeah, this is engineering at its best. So
them tweet. We stand up and watch the girl them tweet. What them a bubble and a wine for me tonight. Yeah.
They are struggling here. Savannah is struggling. Sophia is struggling how to keep the thing up, but she got height, but can she do it without holding it? That is the question.
Question. What did you learn from E4USA robotic arm challenge?
What we learned through the robotic arm challenge is that we needed to complete our objective through set parameters and through our mistakes and failures, we could better design and make the project more stronger and our prototype stronger.
What are some of the things you learned from your failures throughout the robotic arm?
I learned that there's really nothing called failure. With every fail mistake that you make, it helps you improve and better your design to make the final product, to make it even better, stronger, and more efficient. In your project.
How has your initial opinion of engineering changed throughout the year?
My first impression of engineering was that I thought that it was just about wires and hammer and all kind of tools. But when I came to the engineering class, I started learning more about the other type of engineering and how it's everywhere in the world.
One of my names is Manu Hodge-Baines. I attend All Saints Cathedral School. I'm in the 12th grade. And how can you elaborate and describe the five W's?
First, what we want to look at is the five W's. What, who, where, why, and how. What is the problem at hand? Who is the problem affected? Where is the problem at? Why would we create or enhance a design to fix the problem? And how? Through our design process.
Is constructing an underwater turbine ethical?
We have to look through our engineering process to see if it's ethical. And how we're going to do that is by studying the marine life and the people around the Virgin Islands to answer that question.
What can we tell you from what we've learned from the robotic arm challenge into real life scenarios?
What we learned from the robotic arm challenges is there's different types of engineering, such as textile, mechanical and structural engineering, which ties into our next project, the underwater turbine.
Could you elaborate on why did you choose to do an underwater turbine for your next project?
That's a good question, and that leads into our five W's. For the what is because we need clean energy in the Virgin Islands. For the who is for St. Thomas and St. John. For the where is underwater between St. Thomas and St. John. For the why is because of the constant flow of directional current between St. Thomas and St. John's. And how? That's the question.
What type of engineering do we have to look at when constructing and designing the prototype for an underwater turbine? Could you elaborate?
The different type of engineering we would use is one, textile. We would test and try different type of sealant to see which one is more effective underwater for the underwater turbine. Another type of engineering we would use is mechanical engineering for the mechanical parts that is in the turbine. Another type of engineering we will also use is electrical engineering for all the wires that's in the turbine and also the wires that are connected to the St. Thomas and St. John, which is feeding the energy. And another type of engineering we would also use is structural engineering for the frame and the stand of the underwater turbine to help it lock underwater. And another type of engineering we would use is cooling engineering, which will help us see from outside and above water what's going on to see if the underwater turbines need repair or something went wrong in the turbine.
Hello, I'm NASA astronaut Joe Acaba, coming to you from the Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. I want to thank Dr. David Hall and the University of the Virgin Islands faculty, staff, and students for inviting me to share a few words and for working with my NASA colleagues to plan and organize this week-long event. All of this in the midst of a global pandemic. These challenging times have been difficult, so it's important for all of us to remain optimistic and resilient. Despite all, here at NASA, we continue to advance the research and technology to return to the moon. We are still pushing forward with plans to send the first woman and first person of color to the moon under NASA's Artemis program. No human has set foot on the moon since Apollo 17 in 1972, so the possibility of landing on the moon is incredible. As a young kid of Puerto Rican descent, I was born and raised in Southern California. I've always enjoyed math and science, but my interest in becoming an astronaut started with my grandfather. He had old films of the Apollo missions, which we enjoyed watching together. I've been fortunate to have so many mentors who supported me and motivated me to be where I am today. Prior to joining NASA, I served as a member of the United States Marine Corps Reserves. I also spent 2 years as a volunteer in the United States Peace Corps. I worked a lot of different jobs until I found the one that I thought and still believe is the most important job on the planet, and that was being a school teacher. For 5 years, I taught math and science to both middle and high school students in Florida. When I became an astronaut, the International Space Station became my classroom. This allowed me to share my love for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics with students around the world. My hope are to inspire the next generation of explorers and leaders and to elevate and highlight the teaching profession and its importance to our society. As you learn more about NASA and all that we do, I want you to remember you are a lot like an astronaut aboard the space station right now. As a result of COVID restrictions, many of you are feeling somewhat isolated and forced to interact virtually with family and friends. But hang in there. Your mission is to remain optimistic and resilient. Before signing off, I want to give a shout out to the USVI teachers, faculty, students, and staff, and all of those nationally and internationally who are joining us from as far away as Hawaii, Tennessee, the Eastern Caribbean, South Africa, India, and Scotland. And finally, to the student presenters from the USVI Cancrine Junior High School, All Saints School, Gift Hill, and Brentwood High School in Tennessee. Thanks for sharing your vision and science with us.
Welcome, everybody. Dr. Garcia from NASA, if you want to present or get us started, that would be great.
Yes, of course. Hi. Is my audio coming through?
Yes.
Perfect. First and foremost, thank you very much, everybody, for the opportunity to be joining you today. We're truly excited about continuing our partnership there with the Virgin Islands. We know that there are so many different opportunities to connect with you, and we look forward to this event every single year, and every year is different, but with the same purpose, and that is to let you know about all the great things that we are doing at NASA and how you can be a participant in this effort. We know that NASA symbolizes so many different things to a lot of people, and rightfully so. And there are so many things that one can look forward to, but really it's our job to just kind of, you know, let you know what's out there and give you some ideas as to what you can expect as you mature into young professionals. And so we have several individuals that are going to be speaking to you today about what they do and their experiences related to NASA and its mission. So our first presenter is Bree Staden. She's an awesome engineer. She's a tremendous person, and she's going to go ahead and kick us off with her presentation. So, Bree, if you are available and ready, the floor is yours.
Awesome. Thank you, Dr. Garcia.
Thank you.
50 years ago, we went to the moon. We called it Apollo.
What many people don't know is that Apollo had a twin.
She was a woman named Artemis, goddess of the moon.
We are returning to the moon.
As a new generation of explorers.
This time, to stay.
And to prepare to achieve humanity's next giant leap of sending the first human missions to Mars.
We believe our course will redefine what is possible.
That we would discover life-saving,
earth-changing science.
And that the challenges ahead will inspire generations.
This is our manifest.
For all who wondered if we could return.
For all who dreamed of pressing beyond.
This is your calling.
We go for all of America.
We go.
We go as the Artemis generation.
We go.
Awesome. Thank you, Zach, for that video. Hi, everyone. My name is Bree Staten, and I'm a ground integration engineer for the mobile launcher at NASA's Kennedy Space Center here in Florida. And today I'll be talking about how we are sending humans to the moon, Mars, and beyond. So I'm sure you've heard of NASA, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. So we are the United States government agency responsible for aerospace technology and innovation. NASA has 10 centers located all over the country in Virginia, California, Ohio, Alabama, Texas, Maryland, Mississippi, and Florida, which is home to Kennedy Space Center, which is what I will be talking about today. So we are going to the moon. We're returning to the moon, and we're doing that to prepare for Mars. And we are also doing that with Artemis 1. So Artemis is the twin sister of Apollo, goddess of the moon in Greek mythology. And with Artemis 1, we'll see the first woman, the first person of color, and the next man to walk on the surface of the moon. Once we're on the moon's surface, we'll be able to explore resources such as water ice, that is going to prepare us to take the next giant leap of deep space exploration to Mars. So that's a pretty big mission. So how are we going to do that? We've got three main programs here at NASA. We have Exploration Ground System, Space Launch System, and the Orion spacecraft that are going to help us achieve this Artemis mission. So Exploration Ground Systems, or EGS, is located here at Kennedy Space Center in Florida and has established systems and facilities that are necessary for the processing and launching of our rockets. And then we have the Space Launch System, or SLS, which will be the most powerful rocket that we've ever built. We've been stacking it here in the Vehicle Assembly Building for over a year now, in conducting testing leading up to launch early this year in the March-April timeframe. So it's a very exciting time to be at NASA. When we're done with our testing, the SLS will help astronauts begin their journey to explore destinations far into the solar system. And then finally, the Orion spacecraft. So you can see the picture here on the right of the Orion spacecraft, or the Orion crew module. This will actually ride on SLS, taking astronauts farther than they've ever been before. It will make sure that the astronauts are safe during their travel, and also that they return home safely. So what does Exploration Ground Systems do exactly? So EGS is where I work, and we build, we launch, and we recover. So the EGS program utilizes the Vehicle Assembly Building, or the VAB, to build and assemble our rockets. Previously, we had focused on Atlas V rockets during the Apollo era in the 1960s, and then more recently, the famous Space Shuttle program, which ended in about 2011. We're now looking forward to the most powerful American rocket, SLS that's being tested and completed in the VAB right now. Probably the most exciting thing that we do here at EDS is actually launch these rockets. So we have several pieces of equipment which help us do just that, including the crawler transporters, the mobile launcher, the launch control center, and the launch pad, which I'll talk more about. And then finally, we recover. So the most important thing when we're sending astronauts to space is that we also bring them home safely. We have a special landing and recovery team that departs from KSC to recover the capsule on a U.S. Navy ship. They make sure that the astronauts are safe, that all the equipment is working, that there's been no major damage to the crew module. And it's here that the astronauts will experience gravity for the first time in their 25,000-mile trip around to the moon and back. So the vehicle assembly building is big, but just how big is it? Here you can see a picture of the VAB. It was built in 1965, and it's pretty much a giant garage built for rockets. It's currently home to SLS, the largest rocket in NASA history. It's sitting in High Bay 3 right now. The VAB is one of the largest buildings in the world by area. It stands 525 feet tall, so it's kind of hard to even imagine how big it is. Whenever I drive to work, I can see it from about 20, 25 minutes away. And then, of course, when you walk in, you just look straight up because it's just amazing to see how big it is. So a big building obviously has some pretty big doors you could see here. It takes about 45 minutes to open and close the doors. By volume, the VAB can fit 3.5 Empire State Buildings inside. Or if you want to think of it another way, you could fill it with 250 billion ping pong balls. The American flag that you could see up in the top left is 209 feet high and 110 feet wide. So the blue and white stars is the size of an NBA regulation basketball court, and you could drive a school bus down just one of the stripes. And that's just a little tiny part of this building. So overall, the VAB has been a crucial part in American space exploration and has processed 135 space shuttle missions along with 14 Saturn V rockets, and we're just getting started. So there's a lot of math and science involved with getting a rocket to launch, but there's also a lot of important equipment that we've developed over the past 50 years to help us get there. So one of those pieces of equipment is the mobile launcher. Here you can see the mobile launcher out on the crawler transporter, on the crawlerway. And the neat thing about the mobile launcher is you can see it like this on the crawlerway or out at the park site, parked at the launch pad. Or it can also park in the VAB, which is where the mobile launcher is right now. So when pieces of the rocket are brought to Kennedy Space Center to be built, they're loaded onto the mobile launcher inside the VAB, which is then used to assemble, process, and launch NASA's SLS rocket and the Orion spacecraft. There are about 50 subsystems on the mobile launcher. You have electrical systems, hydraulic systems, pneumatic systems. There are also a lot of stabilizers for the vehicle, as well as connectors that supply the vehicle or the rocket with air conditioning or cryogenic fluid and a lot of other things. And those actually, if you've seen videos of rocket launches, you can see them disconnecting at T-minus zero. So some pretty important connectors there. And then you've also got the crew access arm, which is a bridge or a platform that extends out to the vehicle and allows our astronauts to enter the crew module. The white room, which is a really small room at the end of the crew access arm, is the last place that our astronauts are here on Earth before getting into the rocket and blasting off to space. So a pretty important piece of equipment. And then, like I said, that was sitting atop a crawler transporter. So a crawler transporter is pretty much a giant tank. We've got our mobile launcher with our rocket in the VAB, and we need to get it to the launch pad. So how are we going to do that? That's what the crawler transporters are for. So these machines have been carrying rockets and spacecraft to the launch pad for more than 50 years. There are two crawler transporters at Kennedy, and each one is the size of a baseball infield, weighing about 6.6 million pounds. They can carry 18 million pounds, or the weight of more than 20 loaded 777 airplanes. So these are pretty tough machines. Here you can see the kind of gravel that it's sitting on. So the crawler has to actually travel on a special roadway called the crawler way. That is made up of a very specific amount and type of gravel that will allow the crawler transporter to travel without actually bursting or breaking the road underneath of it. When there's a rocket on top, the crawler transporter can move at a whole 1 mile per hour. Whenever the crawler transporter is empty, I've heard it can get up to 2.2 miles per hour. So the trip from the VAB over the launch pad takes several hours, but we couldn't do it without the crawler transporter. And then finally, Pad 39B is the final stop for NASA's SLS rocket here on Earth. This is considered a clean pad, which means that it's not only used for our NASA Artemis missions with the SLS rocket, but it can support other private space companies that wish to launch their own rockets, such as SpaceX or Boeing or ULA or any other vendors. So there are several elements which allow the pad to support these programs. So we have a water tower that holds roughly 400,000 gallons of water, or enough to fill 27 swimming pools, which is used for the ignition overpressure and sound suppression, or IOPSS system, during launch. So there's a lot of exhaust coming from the rocket when we launch that's very loud and very hot, of course. So we use this water to dampen that and keep everything safe. We also have three lightning towers that you see standing around here. These towers direct lightning away from the pad to protect it. Each tower stands 600 feet tall, which is about 75 feet higher than the VAB. And there are actually engineers, technicians that have to climb these lightning towers and inspect them, which I think would be a pretty cool job to have. And then finally, we also have the flame trench. So this is located underneath where the rocket will launch from and is to direct and kind of capture all of the exhaust and flames coming from the rocket at launch. So it's about 1.5 football fields long, and it can withstand a peak temperature of 2,200 degrees Fahrenheit. And then finally, with EGS, we have the Launch Control Center, also known as the LCC. So this is the hub of launch operations at Kennedy and is extremely important as we close in on our mission for Artemis 1. So if you've seen movies or TV shows where people are typing away on computers or doing hand calculations, communicating with astronauts in space, this is where that's going to happen for Artemis 1. So they've been conducting mission simulations to prepare for launch day, and it's coming up pretty soon, so it's getting exciting. LCC is powered by some of the brightest minds in the world, including Charlie Blackwell Thompson. You can see her here in the front with the red hair, and she was in the video at the beginning. Charlie is our current launch director and is actually the first female launch director for NASA. She actually has her own Lego figure. Lego makes a little figure for her, so that's pretty cool. Charlie and her team are responsible for overseeing all processing and launch operations, and some of that includes counting down the launch sequence and also determining a go or no-go on launch day. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about my role at EGS. So like I said in the beginning, I'm a ground site integration engineer for the mobile launcher. So what that means is I pretty much just work with a lot of the other engineers to solve engineering problems on the mobile launcher. And I mostly work on the crew access arm. So the crew access arm is held up by a bracer cable, and it has to be able to extend out to the rocket and then also retract back into the mobile launcher. So I pretty much am preparing for Artemis 1 right now. We have some final testing, final projects that are closing up, trying to get all that paperwork in and get everything resolved so that we know that crew access arm is going to be able to support come launch day. Now for Artemis 1, we won't be launching human astronauts. It's a non-crewed mission. We're actually launching 10 CubeSats. But for Artemis 2, we will be launching astronauts. So that crew access arm is going to be really important. Prior to my current role or job at NASA, I was on the Tech and Fusion team. You can see a picture of my team down here on the right. That group actually targets outdated technology and through a variety of projects aims to kind of improve the technology that we're using here at NASA. So technology progresses very quickly. There's a lot of new and exciting tech out there. And of course we want the best that we can get here at NASA. So we try to take those outdated systems and make them more efficient, pretty much improving the processes and equipment that we have here at NASA. So had some great opportunities at NASA so far. Was able to also co-author a paper for the IEEE Annual Aerospace Conference. Up here you can see a picture of me with the stacked SLS and the VAB. So it's definitely an exciting job, and I'm glad to be here. Now I'm going to talk just a little bit about my education and background, where I came from. So I am from a small town in southern Ohio. So I grew up in the Kentucky, Ohio, West Virginia area. So I'm a little bit far from home, but am happy to be here in Florida. It's definitely weird getting used to the hot weather, but I went to a school in the village of Colgrove, so it's actually not even big enough to be a town, but had heard about the Space Systems Engineering program at Morehead State, which is a public university that was about an hour and a half from my house. And I thought it was interesting, but I thought that, oh, that would be too hard for me. I don't know if I would be capable of doing something like that, because I'd never heard of anything like that before. So I enrolled at Morehead State for a different program, and then I got there and decided to just give it a shot and see what would happen. So I ended up really enjoying the coursework, really enjoying what I was learning in all of my astronomy and physics and engineering classes, and was able to get my degree with a lot of hard work and good support. So during my time there, you can see in the bottom right picture, that's a picture of the Space Science Center's planetarium. So I was actually a planetarium operator, gave a lot of universe tours and sky talks to students, college students and younger students, and was able to learn a lot more about astrophysics and astronomy, which definitely helped whenever I got here at NASA. Also during my time at Morehead State, I was involved in clubs on campus. So we developed the first chapter of the Society of Women in Space Exploration at our university, or SWISE. This is a international club. So there are chapters of this club all around the world. And it pretty much just promotes diversity and inclusion in STEM and provides opportunities for those students to help provide a sense of belonging, and just to give us the tools that we needed to succeed in school. So definitely think that was a big help to me. I was also president of our rock climbing club Here you can see a picture of me on the left, rappelling down a cliff. And I also worked as a program manager for our university's Outdoor Adventures Recreation Program. So if you see that big wooden jungle gym down there, there's a zip line on it. I got to work on our challenge course and lead outdoor trips. We had a little rock climbing wall and things like that. So I definitely think that that sometimes you can get troubleshooting and problem solving skills in different ways than just the traditional STEM class. So I think it's definitely important to continue to do other things while you're in school besides just work really hard and study all the time, because you definitely got to make sure to take care of yourself. If I have any advice, it's just to apply for any opportunity that interests you, not to hold your own self back, and just to kind of reach for your dreams as confidently as you can. So with that being said, I think that I actually have both of the technology and fusion interns on the call right now. And if Lauren Ann and Ed would like to hop on and kind of introduce themselves and talk about how they became interns at NASA. Zach, I don't know how much time we have for that, but
I think we're good.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
Awesome. So you guys can hop on and turn your cameras on. Zach, you might have to give permissions to Lauren Ann.
Oh yeah, give me 1 second here.
Yep.
I'll go ahead and start while he's giving permission. Hi guys, my name's Edward. A little background about myself and how I became a NASA intern. I am a third year aerospace engineering major here at the University of Texas at Austin. I didn't really have an interest for space until late in high school. I guess from there, it kind of kindled my passion. I became more curious about space because there's just so much we don't know about it. And with that, there's so much to discover. And I really just wanted to be a part of those discoveries, which is why I chose aerospace engineering as my major. And I think NASA does such a great job at coordinating these outreach events and opportunities for younger students, but they also do a great job to do this for older students as well, like myself. For me, I was fortunate enough to be able to participate in different projects with NASA in college. And I really believe that these programs have really helped me to gain new skills and also valuable experience that I can share with others. I believe that they've really helped me to make me a better student, but also grow as an engineer and ultimately become a NASA intern. So I highly encourage y'all to continue to participate in these events that NASA hosts, because they're just amazing. And they really will help you gain experience that you can't get anywhere else. Thank you for letting me speak, and I will hand it over to Lauren Ann.
Hello. My name is Lauren Ann Graham, and thank you for having me today. I'm so excited to talk to everybody. So a little bit of my background. I'm actually still a student. I'm a mechanical engineering graduate student at the Florida Institute of Technology here in Florida, actually very close to the Kennedy Space Center. And I also did my undergraduate studies here in aerospace engineering. But for a very long time, even when I was a younger student, all the way back in elementary school and before, it was my dream to work at NASA and be an astronaut and go to space. So I was lucky enough and blessed enough to have just a constant surrounding of people in my life who supported my dreams and my goals, and they fueled it and they believed in me. So I took opportunities and I did everything that I could to just chase that dream. And so that dream kind of came true for me this past year when I received my first NASA internship last semester, actually. I worked in the microgravity lab, also at the Kennedy Space Center, conducting research. And now, like they said, I'm in the tech infusion group over here, still at the Kennedy Space Center, but working towards the Artemis mission. So if you have that dream of, you know, going to space or working for NASA or being an engineer, doing those things, chase it with everything that you have in you and always apply to opportunities that you may think that you don't even qualify for. I know some of my best opportunities that I've gotten, I didn't think I qualified for, or I didn't think I was going to be good enough for those opportunities. But I still applied and ended up getting the opportunities, and they were life-changing and have taught me so much. And so I'm just so grateful to be here during Artemis, and just here to tell you to chase your dreams and go for it and give it your all. And thank you for having me.
Thank you, Lauren. Do we have enough time for Dr. Garcia to present? I know we're kind of cutting it a little close here. Christina? Can anyone hear me?
I hear you, Dad.
Okay. Dr. Garcia, what do you think? I think we close out at 2:15. So in 25 minutes, do you think that's good enough time, Dr. Garcia?
Oh yeah, that's more than enough, Zach. That's
all right. Perfect. So well, then I'll leave it to you.
I'll get my presentation. Hopefully y'all can see my screen.
Yep, we see it.
Awesome. So thank you to all these wonderful young people that are doing amazing things. And to share about your experiences, we know that having role models and people, you know, within certain age groups make a huge difference, especially when they're talking to our younger audiences. So it's really awesome to see our young folks that are doing amazing things here at the Kennedy Space Center. And you all taking the time to share those experiences with even younger students that are going to be coming up right after you all. And so what I just want to give is some information about myself, of course, but also about some of the opportunities NASA has to offer all our young folks. So I am, my name is Samuel Garcia. I am originally from Texas, the border region, a place called the Rio Grande Valley. And so I grew up there with a passion for learning things. I was curious about things. So I really enjoyed reading. I remember growing up, most of our folks nowadays, they grew up they grew up with technology in terms of laptops and iPads and Wi-Fi. But when I grew up, we didn't have access to any of those things. But my exploration came from, you know, walking around my neighborhood and playing with my friends outside and you know, getting underneath my grandma's house. And really curious about, you know, the environment in which we lived. And I remember one of the things that really drew me to my grandmother's house, besides her homemade flour tortillas, was that she had this encyclopedia set. And this, I was just drawn to it. It was the World Book Encyclopedia. And so I remember as a young person, I would go over and see different pictures and learn about history, about science. And so I really had a deep passion for learning at a young age. And of course, my parents and my grandparents valued education because they came from very humble beginnings. So they wanted me and, you know, subsequent generations to go to school and make professional careers. So that way, you know, we wouldn't have to toil in the labor or in the fields all our lives. So I went to school. I became a teacher And then, you know, I earned several other degrees. And so that just goes to show that, you know, education is really important for me. And so it has really, truly changed the course of my family's history and myself, and given me all these opportunities that I never dreamed of, really. I mean, truly. But coming from where we came from, I mean, the only individuals that had college degrees were our school teachers, pretty much. And so we had limited role models that demonstrated this, but education was always at the forefront. My family sacrificed themselves. They, you know, paid, they worked really hard to get me the school supplies, clothing, shoes, you know, things for me to be able to enjoy school and appreciate it, and not having to worry about working and you know, just working and sustaining a family. And so I was able to pursue this career as an educator, and this took me to NASA. And now I do the same thing here. But now, because of the pandemic, we do things virtually now. But the message and the focus and the effort remains the same. And that means we're deeply committed to connecting with students and just displaying the plethora of different opportunities that are out there for them. So these are just some action shots I miss these days. And hopefully in the near future, I'm able to come down to the Virgin Islands and see you all in person. As we mentioned, NASA is phenomenal. I mean, NASA has truly changed the way we live and see things and have a deeper understanding about our place in the universe. And, you know, this began many, many years ago. And I really like to highlight this because, as Bree mentioned, we are currently working on the next iteration of, you know, these missions to the moon that took place in the 60s and 70s. And this one, this time, we're going to stay on the moon, and we are planning to go even further and sending humans to Mars. And so during these 60 years at KSC, KSC has been, you know, kind of the iconic, one of the iconic symbols of this generation of Apollo, but now it's changing, and now this is the Artemis generation, and you folks, you find yourself right in the middle of all this action. And so we are truly, truly living in a unique time. And so we have so many different instruments and missions and projects and programs. I mean, you name it. If you are curious about the world and how it works, I mean, you can definitely find an opportunity to work with us at NASA. And this is just one of the beautiful shots from space of the Virgin Islands here. And so we have, you know, different missions and programs to help study our planet. And we need more and more young minds to help us learn more about our planet. And of course, to send us back to the moon. And this is, of course, our Artemis 1 rocket. It's currently going in testing here at the Vehicle Assembly Building, and we're looking forward to its rollout to the pad here in the next month or so before before the uncrewed test flight to the moon. And so you all are truly living in a really unique point in time here. And so you have a doorway, right? You have this pathway to all these different things to be connected and support these Artemis missions. And you know, it always goes to, I think it's always helpful to demonstrate and showcase the different people that are working with Artemis, and especially the astronauts that are training for these historic missions to the moon and beyond. And so we see all these wonderful, amazing, talented, highly decorated individuals that have sacrificed so much of their time and energy and you know, to advancing their training to become these individuals that are going to be working and living on the moon. And you see here, it's very diverse. We like to acknowledge the diversity here, and we're truly excited about who this these individuals are going to be making history, who they are, who they're going to be, and the impact they're going to have far beyond after they complete their missions to the moon. So this could be you, right? This could be you helping to support these Artemis missions. But now I want to, you know, continue this line of thought here. And we need, of course, astronauts that individuals that are risk takers, that are brave, that are explorers, that just want to learn more, and they're unafraid, right? And to push the boundaries and help us explore into deep space. But we also need many other individuals that help us with different missions and projects and programs at NASA. So, you know, internships are really important for students to be plugged in, to get experience, and to, you know, to grow as a career professional. So I love having these two interns with us because they demonstrate, you know, the energy, the usefulness, and, you know, their skill sets, and how they're going to contribute and contributing to NASA's missions at such a young age. We have opportunities for individuals to participate as technicians, people that work on construction, building the launch pads, flight controllers, food scientists that help us understand how to develop appropriate foods for astronauts to eat in space, and of course, how to grow plants and crops in space. Social media experts, people who work in communications, geologists, folks that are in charge of all different aspects of design, whether it's graphic, the arts, spacesuits, robotics, astronaut trainers, you name it. This is just a glimpse. This is just an example of the different careers that exist at NASA. And then I always love to talk about and mention the arts. The arts are so critical. Many of us grew up learning, you know, really appreciating art, how to draw, music, dance, poetry. You know, those are really important, right? Those gives us a different perspective. They help us think critically and see the world differently. And so our artists and artistic skill sets are extremely valued because they help us present, you know, our findings and our research in a really unique way, right? Something that the written word can't do. And so we need artists to help us with the mission patches. We need artists to help us create murals for our workspace and help capture the past, the present, but also the future of our work. And so that's the beauty of blending both the STEM aspects, but also the arts. And so I know that when I see something visually, it tends to resonate with me much more than, you know, seeing words on a paper, right? When you see something, it calls it, it triggers some emotions and something deep inside of us, I think, that helps us want to explore and learn more about what we see in these images, because they tell you so much, right? And hopefully you're able to explore this if you do indeed have a deep need and desire to become an artist. Educators, we know educators are the backbone of our societies and communities. And so, you know, educators are they're doing a tremendous work, and they contribute so much to the work that we do here at NASA as well. And of course, our students, we can't forget about you. We love you all. You know, we are thoroughly committed to providing our students the best opportunities for growth, for development, but also for profession and career opportunities. And so just like Bree mentioned, take advantage of it. There are so many different opportunities for you to join us at NASA. And before I conclude today's my talk, just want to mention that there are so many ways, and you know, now with technology, you can access these different videos and activities. So you can do a lot of this learning at home, right? Things that I couldn't do when I was young, you're able to do it at the touch of your hand with a phone, right? And so this is truly a great way, a great time to utilize technology for your own development, right? And so I encourage you to learn more about Artemis by drawing Artemis. And you can share your work with us there by using the hashtag. So I look forward to seeing your work on social media here in the next couple of weeks. So my friends, are you ready to join our crew? Because this is a call to you. This is truly a time for you to jump on board, help us out with the work that we're doing, and demonstrate to the world that, you know, that we can do amazing things if we work together. So that concludes my presentation. And I think we got about 10 more minutes for Q&A.
Yes. Ms. Josiah, did you guys have questions? I can see you typing, but I can't get them. So very quickly, Dr. Morris, are you on?
Yeah, I'm here, Christina. Can you guys hear me?
Okay. Yeah, perfectly. So if we don't have any questions, I know Ms. Josiah was working on them with her young ones. So while we're waiting, and they'll be St. Peter and St. Paul will be on every day this week in this 1 hour time slot. So if we don't get them today, we'll definitely get them tomorrow. But did you want to talk about the observatory, our opportunities and ways that teachers can leverage science and UVI?
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, anyone who has questions, drop them in and we'll take them as we go. But really quickly, my name is David Morris. I'm a professor of astronomy and physics at the University of Virgin Islands. I've been in St. Thomas for about 10 years. I came down there from NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, which is the NASA center that's just outside Washington, D.C. And for the entire time that I've been here at UVI, we have, well, maybe not the entire time. We probably started doing NASA internships with our students at UVI in the second or third year that I was in St. Thomas. And ever since then, every year you heard about some of the interns, you heard from some of the interns that are working at NASA centers right now. I don't want you to think that that's just students from, you know, from the States. That's students from St. Thomas and it's students from St. Croix. And I don't think we actually sent anyone from St. John yet, but I hope we will soon. Every year, UVI sends anywhere between 5 and 15 students to NASA centers around the country. Now, fairly enough, the last 2 years, we've all done these internships remotely. But prior to that, we were sending students to Huntsville, Alabama, which is where Marshall Space Flight Center is. We sent students often to Goddard Space Flight Center outside Washington, D.C., where I came down from. And just this last year, we sent students for the first time to Kennedy Space Center. So we're super excited. We've had students working at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, which is another NASA center out in California. So these are students from your communities, right? This could be you in a few years. So if you're interested in learning more about how you can be one of these students that goes on and does a NASA internship, and I should also say some of those students have gone on and actually been employed after graduation at NASA centers. So this could be a career for you. And we've sent students from the territory through to these careers. And it all starts, like you've heard some of the current interns talking about, it all starts with your interest. If you're interested in astronomy and physics, so we don't have a planetarium at UVI, but what we have, you heard Christina saying, we've got an observatory on St. Thomas. If you'd like to learn a little bit about the stars and how astronomers do their work, how they take scientific measurements of the stars, running the telescope, looking through the telescope and analyzing scientific data, just like an astronomer at NASA, come and talk to us. We'll be happy to teach you everything there is to know about doing astronomy at our observatory, get you involved in those projects. If you're a teacher and you would like to get your class up to the Edelman Observatory and learn a little bit more about the kind of astronomy and physics and engineering that we do at UVI in collaboration with our NASA partners, by all means, please contact me. There are challenges right now, I know, with the pandemic and doing things safely, getting students in a space that's safe for them, but we'll absolutely work with you to do whatever we need to do to make sure that we have a safe experience for you and get your students a chance to see what it's about, what doing NASA science at UVI is all about. So I know we're running short on time, but I suppose I'll just close by saying that we're always excited to have our NASA friends and colleagues present at these education outreach activities. And I'm more excited this year than ever before, I think, because each year that we've done these opportunities, they've gotten bigger. And each year that's gone on, as you've heard me talk about, we've been sending more and more students to NASA centers. And now that we've been doing it for about 6 or 7 years now, we're even seeing the students that came, that learned about these programs, like you're doing today in your classrooms in our public schools in St. Thomas and St. Croix. They've come to UVI, they've done some research projects, they've gone off and done internships at NASA centers in the summer, and then they've gone on to be employed at NASA centers for their career. So this is exactly what we hoped this program would do, and we're seeing that it is doing just that. And I hope that some of you guys that are listening to us today and have been inspired by what you've heard are going to be the next students that come to us at UVI, learn about how to get involved in these projects at NASA centers over the summer, and maybe find yourselves working in a NASA center after graduation. So thank you all for listening to us. If you have any questions at all, want to get involved, want to know how to take that next step, just reach out to Christina, reach out to myself. Be happy to give you all the information you need. Thank you all so much. And thank you to our NASA colleagues for all the fantastic information, sharing your stories. And thank you. Huge thank you to Christina for setting all of this up. Without Christina Chanis and all of her fantastic efforts, none of this would be possible. None of you guys will be hearing about this. It's all due to her tremendous efforts in putting this together and getting you all the opportunity to learn all about how to become the next NASA researcher. So thank you all. Thanks for your time. And Christina, I'll turn the floor back to you. Oh, thank you, Bree. Was that you? Thanks. Thanks so much for sharing your story. I know I just met you today, but really excited to hear your story. It's super cool. And I hope you'll see some of our students up there at your center real soon. Christina, back to you. Actually, it looks like maybe we've lost Christina. Do we still have Christina on?
I don't see her in the attendee list. She must have dropped off.
We may have dropped off.
I mean, we're about at time. So, I appreciate everybody attending, and I'm glad we had the opportunity to do that. So thank you, Dr. Morris.
Thank you, Zach.
Have a great rest of your day, everyone who joined. Bye.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.
All right, bye.